Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer Memorial Lecture. We are looking forward to a very insightful and enlightening lecture. To proceed with the lecture, I invite the dignitaries on the dais. I request them to take their seats. So the chair, we are expecting him shortly. So he will be here shortly. So I request Professor Sukhdeo Thorat, the speaker today, to please come on the dais and be seated. And I invite and request Irfan Engineer to please be on the dais. I also request Irfan Engineer to please say a few words about the center.
Good evening, friends. It is a pleasure to be here this evening with all of you. And I'm so thankful to all of you for this response. Many people have worked for this lecture. Most of all, Professor Sukhdeo Thorat, who has been working for months on this lecture. It's a pleasure to have you, to have all of you here. Center has been organizing these lectures in memory of Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer. This is the 9th Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer Memorial Lecture. Some of the others that were organized before include Professor Imtiaz Yusuf of Mahidol University, Bangkok, and his lecture was on Islam-Buddhism relations in Southeast Asia, with special reference to Myanmar and Thailand. The second lecture was delivered by Professor Mushirul Hassan, Meaning, Metaphor, and Martyrdom in Colonial India. The third memorial lecture was delivered by Sri Wajahat Habibullah, the former chairperson of Minorities Commission and the first Chief Information Commissioner. And his lecture was on Islam in India, Challenge or Promise. The fourth lecture was delivered by Professor Faizan Mustafa, Vice Chancellor of Nalsar Law University. And the topic was Freedom of Religion in India, Contemporary Challenges. Fifth lecture was delivered by Professor Romila Thapar, and the topic was Indian Society and the Secular. Sixth lecture was delivered by Professor Christoph Jefferlot, and his topic was Dr. Ambedkar and Democracy. Seventh lecture was delivered by Professor Dietrich Rieds from Germany, and his topic was Muslim Global Actors from South Asia, World Making from the Margins of Islamic World. Eighth lecture again was by Professor Christoph Jefferlot in Mumbai on the same, the earlier lecture was in Delhi, and the next lecture was in Mumbai, and the topic was again Dr. Ambedkar and Democracy. And this is the 9th lecture. Center has been working, its main objective is to promote communal harmony in the country, address the prejudices nurtured by particularly against minorities, and monitor communal violence in the country, counter these prejudices, and promote communal harmony. We have 8 peace centers all over the country which are promoting communal harmony. Center publishes journal, Indian Journal of Secularism. We organize seminars, lectures, publications, publish books on to promote communal harmony and for better understanding of relations between different communities. And we organize memorial lecture. These memorial lectures are generally well received, and we are really very, very lucky to have Professor Sukhdeo Thorat to deliver this 9th memorial lecture. Before we proceed with this, I'll invite our guest today, Javed Mirza, who is settled in US but was on India visit and has come specially from Hyderabad for this lecture. I invite Javed Mirza to say a few words about Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer.
Respected professor and members of the audience, good afternoon. It's a great pleasure for me to be here on this occasion of Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer being remembered through lectures on topics that he really believed in and worked all his life. I had the pleasure of being a host of Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer many times when he was in New York, and also having long discussions with him. What made me attracted towards Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer was his unique approach to problems. He was not content with superficial analysis. He went into socioeconomic aspects of a problem. Socioeconomic aspects is something that he derived by doing detailed investigation of things. He was, after 20 years of working as an engineer, gave up his job and decided that he'll be a social worker. As part of a social worker, he chose the field of communalism. How does society learn to live with each other? What are the inhibiting factors which make, you know, these communal problems come about? With this main topic, he went about investigating over 100 communal incidents, almost everything, every incident that happened after independence. And from that, he deduced that there were, you know, deep socioeconomic problems, not just mouthing of some slogans or just phraseology dealing with, you know, cow meat or azan or these sort of topics here. So this breakthrough in understanding is what made him distinctive, is what contributed to social thought. And that's where he stands as a pioneer in doing that. I would like to remind you that Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer was a man who combined scholarship with activism. Scholarship by the fact that he wrote over 70 books on various topics, topics that he believed in, but communal issues were his prime target areas. Activism was when he stood up to fight against the communal problems, not only by investigating, going there personally, but also by taking up how does a society react to this? How does an organization deal with this? So he started an organization called Ekta. And the point of Ekta was to forge communal friendship, harmony, and, you know, to overcome the divide that society has placed between, you know, people of different religious communities, different state of societies, different castes. So that way he was a scholar activist. Along with being a scholar activist, part of the activism was reformism. In a very traditional Islamic society, he brought about the idea that, you know, Islamic society is something that has to cope up with modern day society, which means bring about reforms so that the interpretation of Islam should be done in accord with what is happening in today's life. He took the example of liberation theology, which was sort of very much rampant in especially in South America. So with that, he said that religion can be definitely a tool for progress. It is how you interpret that. And he sought among the scholars and himself through his articles to interpret it in a way where, you know, society moves forward and is not reactionary or going backward. Within his own Bohra community from which he came, you know, he realized that the establishment was very conservative, very archaic, and even exploitative. So with that, he dared to oppose the leader of the Bohra community, and for which, you know, he was assaulted so many times. He was assaulted in Cairo, in Hyderabad, at his home, in his office. There were like 5 fatal attacks, but he never budged. So that was the quality of the man. Believing in social justice, because of the injustices that prevalent in society, he was an early proponent of the Mandal Commission. Mandal Commission advocating that there has to be a compensation or a readjustment of social factors and forces through reservations. So he was a very early proponent of that, supporter of that. And by doing a class analysis, a Marxian analysis, he understood that society must be looked up not only, you know, through the conventional lens, but also through the lens of how social dynamics, class dynamics take place and, you know, propel it in a direction where there is more fairness, more equity, and there is more happiness. So it gives me great pleasure to talk about him, somebody that I had known personally quite a bit. And I hope that the center here proceeds likewise many times in inviting dignitaries like Professor Sukhdeo and others here and deals with issues which are relevant today. And as you know, we are facing troubling times. And if we don't deal with them, then of course, you know, we see no solutions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Javed Bhai, for that, for remembering Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer for all of us. Of course, we know his contribution, but nevertheless, it is always good to remember and remind ourselves of that. Friends, today evening, Sri Dinesh Waghmare, who was to chair this lecture, is busy in a meeting in a Mantralaya. As usual, it happens last moment, IAS officer and important position. We are hoping that he comes soon, but it is my pleasant duty to introduce Professor Sukhdeo Thorat. If I were to introduce him well and in all details, we would be spending quite a lot of time. I propose to give a brief introduction because we all know him. And not only that, we want to hear him more rather than about him. Yet, just to recall, Padma Shri Sukhdeo Thorat is an economist and was the former chair of University Grants Commission and Indian Council of Social Science Research. He has been a research associate of International Food Policy Research Institute, Washington, D.C., since 1992. He is also Director, Indian Institute of Dalit Studies, New Delhi, from January 2003 to February 2006. Currently, he is Professor Emeritus in Center for the Study of Regional Development, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Professor Thorat has been member of several bodies like Council for Advancement of People's Action and Rural Technology, which we call CAPART in popular parlance, Social Justice Division of the then Planning Commission, Academic Council of Baba Saheb Bhimrao Ambedkar University, Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, Center of Buddhist Studies, University of Hyderabad, Himachal Pradesh University, and in the governing bodies of many more institutions. I call upon Sanjaya Mhatre to honor Professor Sukhdeo Thorat with token of appreciation. I will introduce the chair as and when he comes and honor him too. I'm sure he's stuck up in very important meeting in Mantralaya, which is unavoidable, and he'll be soon with us because we communicated even today morning with him about this lecture and kept him informed, and we are expecting him sooner rather than later. But at present, without much ado, we are all eager to hear Professor Sukhdeo Thorat, and so I invite him to deliver this 9th Asghar Ali Engineer Memorial Lecture. Thank you, Professor Thorat.
First, this is second. Yeah. Well, good afternoon, good evening, rather. Irfan engineers, the director of the Center for Society and Secularism, ladies and gentlemen. Well, I am really indeed very happy to be here to give a memorial lecture in the memory of one of the important person who has really contributed quite significantly on one of the very important social cause. I do remember that Dr. Ambedkar, in one of his very celebrated speech in Pune, Ranade, Gandhi and Jina, he compared Ranade with Jina and Gandhiji. Please come in, find out some place. Yeah. I was sharing with you the one of the speech of Dr. Ambedkar, which he delivered in Pune on Ranade, Gandhi and Jina. And there he tried to define who is a great person. And I don't want to go into greater detail, but he laid down three criteria. One is that a person should be knowledgeable. Ignorant person cannot be a person who can serve society. Knowledge is an important condition, but knowledge can be used for wrong purpose. We have a very long tradition in this country of using the knowledge for wrong purposes. So knowledge should be combined with sincerity, so that you can sincerely, honestly put up the issues before the society. But again, if you are a knowledgeable person and a sincere person, you can be a very excellent armchair professor like me, or like many others. And Dr. Ambedkar would say that the one who uses knowledge and sincerity for the upliftment of the people, their level of living, is the one who is recognized as a great person. I think that by definition, I think Asghar Ali engineer uses knowledge, his sincerity to address one particular cause and many causes, and try to bring some change in the society, whatever little, whatever big it is. And therefore, he deserved to be remembered. And I'm very happy that I have been invited to give this memorial lecture. Friend, I decided to discuss on this occasion one of the very important issues which was close to his heart, as Grelli engineer's heart, and that is the issue of human rights, that is the issue of secularism. And therefore, I have decided to discuss the issue of why untouchability, caste discrimination and atrocity still persists, despite law. I am going to share some of my reflection on causes and persistence and solution. Why this issue? The issue I have decided to speak simply because this has become a very important issue in Maharashtra. Increase in the atrocities after 2030s in a very significant manner, which has led to allegation by some that Dalit register false cases, and therefore there has been a demand that that there should be a provision of punishment against those who register false cases in the Act itself. Some even went to the extent of saying that the Act should be abandoned. And for the first time in a Maharashtra society, which has a very long legacy of being the place of anti-caste movement, I'll refer to that later on, we could see a caste divide, a community divide, with a massive mobilization on the street by two different communities, the one who opposes and the one who supports. And therefore, I thought it is necessary that this issue is discussed in a more passionate manner, without bringing any emotion into it, and place it on the basis of evidence, so that we can work together and take this issue further, because Maharashtra has a very great legacy of anti-caste movement, anti-untouchability movement. If you ask me, no other state has such a strong no other state has such a strong legacy of social movement, anti-caste, anti-untouchability movement, movement for the cause of women. I mean, you have to, and the important thing is that the social reformer came from all section of society. From the Brahmin community, you have the son of Lokmanya Tilak, who in fact set up and social equality organization, which was set up by Dr. Ambedkar, but he set up the office. He showed a courage to invite Dr. Ambedkar and his team to his house and provided a meal and invite a lot of anger from his own family. You have Ranades, you have Sane Guruji. I can name you many of them who have come from the Brahmin background. You have a series of them from the Marathas and the OBCs. You can begin with Shivaji, and you can begin with come down to Shahu Maharaj, come down to Maharshi Shinde, Patil, Namdev, Tukaram. You can pick up anybody. Gadge Maharaj, Tukdoji Maharaj. There are a series of people, those who have come from Maratha background and the OBC background, who got indulged into the social movement. And of course, among the Dalit, I did not name. Kishan Phaguji Bansot came from Nagpur, More came from Marathwada region, Kamble, Shiva Januba Kamble from Pune, and of course Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. We have this great legacy of social movement, and therefore this caste divide between the community explain explicitly in caste term is something which is not the legacy of Maharashtra, and it's a lot more disturbing. And therefore, I decided to bring some clarity and share my thought with you, so that we can discuss this issue together the way others have discussed. I will discuss four themes, address four themes. The first thing will be that what has been the change and what continues in terms of practice of untouchability and atrocities. Atrocity is the main focus. Second, why untouchability and atrocity still persist despite law? You had in slavery in USA, And the day the law was passed, within a period of 2 to 3 months, slavery disappeared. And you do not even find the stretches of slavery. Of course, race discrimination persists. But slavery disappeared because there was a law. We had an Anti-Untouchability Act in 1955, and untouchability still persists in a very significant way. So why untouchability and atrocity still persist? That is the issue which will take some of my time. And then lastly, what can we do? What the government can do, at least to minimize, if not to eliminate, or to use Dr. Ambedkar's word, to annihilate the caste, but at least we minimize the atrocity and untouchability. And lastly, then, in the course of my discussion, I will try to answer some of the allegations made by some section of the society that Dalit registered false cases, and that there should be a provision in the Atrocity Acts for a penalty against those who file false cases. I will discuss this issue, whether this is legally and morally correct to do. Well, let me come to the some provision in the Constitution and the legal provision very briefly. I would not like to go into greater detail in the section on fundamental rights, but it is good enough for me to mention that Constitution is based on the principle of equality and non-discrimination. There are many other provisions, but these provisions which are concerned with the Atrocity Act and Untouchability Act are very prominent in the Constitutions. That there is no discrimination on the basis of caste, religion, race, gender, or place of origin. It has been very emphatically mentioned. And this is important to mention that this overturned the Manusmriti completely. It negated the Manusmriti completely, which is based on the principle of inequality. But what is important is that because of Dr. Ambedkar, untouchability is also brought into the fundamental rights, and untouchability is prohibited and made a punishable offense. Remember well, untouchability is in a section on fundamental rights in the Constitution. Now, as a follow-up of this provision in the Constitution, that constitutions recognize equality, Constitution recognize non-discrimination, that everybody should have equal status, equal facility, equal opportunities, irrespective of social identity. But in practice, you find just the opposite. And therefore, the directive principle of the Indian Constitution put responsibility on the state to pass laws and the policies to achieve the goals set out in the fundamental rights. So you have an equality, you have a principle of non-equality, equality and non-discrimination. How do we remove the discrimination that persists in the society? And therefore, right in 1955, 5 years after after the Constitution, Dr. Ambedkar being at the helm of the affair of the Constitution making, began to articulate the Untouchability Act, and Untouchability Offence Act was passed since 1955. It was followed by an Atrocity Act in 1989. I'll come to that in later detail as to why we had an Atrocity Act, despite the fact that we had an Untouchability Act. And Atrocity Act again was amended a couple of times, but most recently in 2015 by this very government. Now, let me briefly tell you about these two acts, and then I go to the implementation of this act. The Untouchability Offence Act, as everybody knows, I think the Secretary knows very well and other people knows very well. There are people from NGOs here, is here, yeah. That it has a minimum provision that all public facilities or private which are for the public, everybody should have equal access. And if the untouchables, former untouchables are denied, there is a punishment. That is the limited provision of the Untouchability Offence Act. It was named as a Protection of Civil Rights Act in 1976 by the committee. Now, in 89, our government brought in another act called Atrocity Act. Now, why is it that the Atrocity Act is brought in? And what is the difference between the Untouchability Act and Atrocity Act? What government discovered in the course of implementation of the Untouchability Act is that there was an opposition by higher caste to the untouchable seeking an equal right. But that opposition was not democratic. That opposition was not through discussion. That opposition was through violence and atrocities. So therefore, an act was brought in wherein, in the beginning, 23 behavior of the high caste which involve violence, psychological as well as physical, were considered to be atrocities and subject to punishment. Now, in the amendment of 2015, that forms of behavior has been enhanced to 37 behavior, which are considered to be against the law and which are considered to be atrocities. Now, Supreme Court has very rightly defined these offenses. They say that it is a special class. They are not covered by the IPC, Indian Penal Code, or they are not even covered by the Untouchability Act. They are a special class of atrocities, special caste of violence, and offenses being shockingly cruel and inhuman. This is a very appropriate word. I do not know whether you are having a look at the video that is put up on the social media. Shockingly, I cannot describe any word. Anyway, I don't want to deviate from that. Please have a look at that video, which is the incidence of only 8-10 days. Now, these are the two acts. The Untouchability Act provide the Dalit an equal access. In the event of opposition, they have a legal protection. They can go to the court and get the access. But if the opposition by the high caste is in violent form, mental, physical, or otherwise, then also the untouchable have a legal protection, safeguard, that they can go to the court. Now, this is the law which is brought in by the government to provide an equal access, an equal right, an equal citizenship right to the Dalit. Now, therefore, the question that arises, why is it that the atrocity and the discrimination still persists despite the enactment of this law? Now, before I do that now, let me now share with you how untouchability still persists despite the act. I am not talking of atrocity now. I am taking only Untouchability Act, which indicates that in the public sphere and the private sphere, which provide services in the public sphere, the private providing services which are public, for example, Kirana shop, it's owned by a private person, but it serves the public. And if there is a discrimination for the Dalit, then it is considered to be a violation. So public government services as well as the private services supplied for the public consumptions are considered to be offenses. And why do they still persist? Now, Anti-Untouchability Act is in practice since 1955. Now, it is very difficult to provide the evidence. And since the discussion in Maharashtra, on the street and in the demonstration, is surcharged with emotion and slogan, I thought that I must try to bring some facts and boil down to the emotion to a certain fact so that people can listen what exists. Now, I look for the evidence, and fortunately, I got a number of studies. They are all in Marathi. I translated them into English. Now, please have a look at that. That act was passed in 1955 by the central government. We fortunately have a study immediately of why Taluka in 1958 of 17 villages. This was conducted by Gokhale Institute of Politics and Economics. Followed after that, in 1962, we have another study of 25 villages. This was by the Harijan Sevak Sangh. Followed after that, after 8 years of gap, we have another study of 192 villages, Harijan Sevak Sangh and Gokhale Institute combined. Then again, after 10 years in 1991, of a Marathwada survey conducted by SNDT University, Department of Social Work. This survey is about 95 villages. In 2000, the Action 8 organization in Delhi conducted a survey of 50 villages. They surveyed 500 villages all over India. I was the author of that book, Untouchable and Rural India. Then in 2013, 20 villages were surveyed by my institute, Indian Institute of Dalit Study, and that was confined mainly to economic discrimination. And you have series of data, 2013 to 2016, I pick up only 52 cases submitted by the NCDHR, Ujjwal Uke, he's sitting here, to the parliamentary committee which came here to Maharashtra. This parliamentary committee was touring India for the amendment to the Atrocity Act of 2015. So I think Ujjwal Uke and his friend gave a memorandum with a list of the 52 cases in a detailed manner, so I have taken that. Now let us see what does this tell. Now it is beyond my capacity to tell you that how I can describe this. Therefore, what I will try to do is to summarize and send the central messages of all this study. 1955 to 2016, it's a very long period. And remember well, that if somebody asks me what is your national income, I can immediately tell this is my national income. What is your age, I can tell what is my age. But capturing social relation between the people, between the high caste and Dalit, which are embedded into social relationship and which are of a discriminatory nature, which are only experienced by the Dalit, very, very difficult to capture in the world. But I tried, and what I get is the following. There are four generalization I can make with all the limitation, and this generalization of social change in the untouchability are the following. There are many spheres where Dalit have got access without any differential treatment. They can enter into police station, they can walk into post office. So sphere like that, or sit in the bus, they won't face generally discrimination. So there are sphere, type of sphere, the number of them, I am giving you sample, where Dalit really have got an equal access, which they did not have earlier, without differentiation, without discrimination. There is other category that we have found, is that there is an access, but with a differential treatment of various type, with a discriminatory treatment of various type. You can have an access to well, which is a public well, nobody can deny. It will be against the law. But in practice, what happened in the villages? That, okay, the high caste will have a first priority, the Dalit will take the water later on. Or Dalit would not touch the tap at all, somebody will pour water into their vessel. Or if they take the water from the tap, a high caste person will come and wash and clean up the tap because it is polluted because of Dalit has touched the tap. So you have an access to water, but with a differential treatment, with humiliation, with discrimination. But nevertheless, you have an access. The same story sometime in temples, you know. You can just go in, enter into the temple, but you can't enter into the inside of the temple. You are a panchayat member, you have a legal right to sit and participate, but you sit on the floor or you sit on the chair, that's fine. But you will have a separate cup for yourself to take tea, or if the same cup is used, you are required to wash it. So you get an access, but with a humiliation, with a differential treatment. There are many spheres. I don't have a time to go into greater detail, but you get an idea the things, how things have changed over a period of time. But there are other spheres where there is no access whatsoever. And in fact, in this sphere, which I have said that there is an access with a differential treatment, in many villages you find, particularly in Marathwada, that Dalit do not have entry to the temple, sometimes they do not have entry to the tap, so they have a separate tap or separate well. So there are spheres where they don't have, public sphere, where they don't have access to at all, access to facilities. Now there are two spheres which you must understand. And those spheres have not changed at all. And that is the private sphere, where law cannot do anything. And the private sphere invariably comes out that there is all the villages, there is a residential segregation. There is no question of Dalit having a house in the locality of high caste in the villages. So residential segregation remains. The Dalit are not invited inside the house, or there are no inter-dining inside the house. No question of intermarriages, of course. So there, the private sphere is a very little change you can see. Now this is the change of untouchability, which means that untouchability has changed in some sphere, but in a very substantial sphere of social relationship of Dalit with high caste, the untouchability and differential treatment and denial of rights still persist. Let me come to atrocity now, very briefly. The atrocity rule, as I said, there are about 23 forms of behavior of the high caste which are considered to be against the law. Now again, I want to give the facts. I don't want to talk about on the basis of emotion. This is Maharashtra data. The prime source is crime in India, which is brought out by the Ministry of Home. And I have again taken 52 cases which are submitted by the NCDHR to the parliamentary committee. So these two set of data gives you an idea what is the incidence of the atrocities. And atrocity has really led to this debate in Maharashtra. Atrocity Act was passed in 1989, but the rules to implement that act was passed in 1995. So we can really begin with 1995 till today. And so I have picked up the data from 1995 to 2015. And what do you find in Maharashtra? That about 22,000 cases are registered by the Dalit during this period, on an average of 1,600 cases per year. In the beginning, in 1995, about 1,602 cases were registered, and they reduced up to 2005. There was a declining trend. But after 2005, the number exceeded 1,000 per year, and it reached to 1,670 in 2013, 1,768 in 2014, and 1,816 in 2015. These are the Crime in India report, which are even brought out by the Inspector General of Police in the report that they submitted to the government. I'll come to that later. Now you can see this, that the atrocity persists. What is important, that there is not a single year when the atrocities are not registered by the Dalit. So atrocities are on rise. There is no year without which the atrocity doesn't happen. So altogether, if you take untouchability, that is discrimination, denial of equal right to Dalit, that persists despite a positive change, and that at the same time there is opposition by high caste. That is the most difficult part of it. The discrimination persists because there is opposition, and that comes under the Atrocity Act. And that opposition is not democratic. That opposition is not through court. That opposition is not through negotiation. That opposition is through violence of a various type. Now let me tell you very briefly what kind of violence is committed by the high caste on the Dalit. Very briefly, I do not know whether the paper is being circulated or available. The paper is 37 pages long, and you will get entire data. And there, those who are interested should look at the paper. But these are the type of violences: verbal, caste abuse, humiliation, forcibly consume undesirable things such as urinating in the mouth, parading naked, removing moustaches, and shaving heads. Physical violence include attack, abdication, murder, torture, beaten to death, burned to death, cut the body into pieces, and damaging property. Community level violence: boycott, arson, riot, fire to house, property, and group attack. Then there are sexual violence. Yeah. Sexual assault, sexual harassment, molestation, rape, gang rape, rape in front of relatives, outraging modesty, stripping women naked, and parading naked. Because the high caste know that this is the punishment that can hurt most. So hurt heavily where it hurt most, and that is what is being done. Now there are two features I would like to mention, and they are relevant for the sake of Maharashtra also. And these were not earlier. And this new feature is that earlier an individual will oppose equal right to Dalit. But now the trend for last 20 years and in Maharashtra is that the community as a whole is opposing it. So there is a group organization and mobilization which oppose the Dalit having an equal right. And there is a second feature is that there is a multiple atrocities. Earlier possibility you oppose the Dalit and you either assault him or abuse him and leave the matter there. But today, if you look at there is a table in the lecture, is that the atrocity is multiple in nature. You are abused, you are physically assaulted, and sometimes you are killed. So there is a series of things. If the victim happens to be a woman, you abuse, you humiliate, you sexually assault, and to hide the crime, you killed. So there are multiple forms of atrocity which are used in a combined form from a group. Now what is the meaning of these two new features? The meaning of these two new features is that the caste group atrocities imply caste animosity that is rising. And caste divide and collective effort and on the part of the community. Now this is not what we are looking for. We are looking for negotiation. We are looking for people coming together and dealing the issue of untouchability together. On the contrary, what we find now, that there is a divide. And in Maharashtra, of course, the divide is of an order which I cannot imagine, that one community against the other community. Now, this is what Atrocity Act is. Now, let me come to the question. So, I have presented you a story based on the facts. What is the nature of change in caste discrimination or untouchability and atrocities? The summary and the conclusion of these, that there has been a positive change in certain sphere of untouchability, Dalit getting an equal right, but in a very substantial sphere, they continue to face discrimination. Sometimes equal access with discrimination, sometimes complete denial, and that the opposition is becoming increasingly violent, antisocial, and the nature of atrocities are something which are shocking in the word of the Supreme Court. Now, the issue is why this exists, why the untouchability still exists. I'm only analyzing now what is the role of Atrocity Act or Untouchability Act. Why, despite law, the untouchability still persists, discrimination still persists on a significant, unacceptable level. Now, what I'm going to do is, again, I have picked up three sources. Fortunately, I got the three sources. 52 cases by NCTHR, Ujjwal Uke. I thank him because he has accumulated all these cases, 52 cases, and very detailed. But one of the most important study, the ESDA study, it is study by 33 cases by of Latur in 2008 and 2010, but this is by the lawyer, those who are legal expert, and they have analyzed the implementation of Atrocity Act. Then there is, of course, the report submitted to the parliamentary committee. And finally, the Rural Development Center of Marathwada. I don't remember the name of Eknath Ahad's centers, you know, the famous man. On the basis of this, there's a detailed analysis of the atrocity, implementation of the Atrocity Act. Again, I can't go into greater detail, so I will share with you in a brief, in summary form, as to how the implementation of Atrocity Act happens. This is the main findings that comes out, and this is based on the fact. This is not out of imagination. What comes is the following. Let me tell you one thing. That 1995 Act of Atrocities, 89 Act, has a rule, 1995, and the police administration must follow the rule when atrocity happens. And they have to follow as per the book of law. But what happened is that there is a huge and massive deviation from the rules as far as the implementation of the Atrocity Act is concerned. Now, these are the deviation, and for each of these, there is a detailed statistical evidence I have produced in the paper. Please read it. Late registration of FIR, not in prescribed time. There is a prescribed time in the rule, but invariably what is being done is that the registration is being done late. And why it is done late on purpose, I'll share with you later. There is a purpose behind that. Delay in spot investigation. The moment atrocity happens, the police is required to go on the spot and get the actual situation. Appointment of the officer below the rank. There is a requirement in the untouchability or rule that a particular level officer should go and not the ordinary person or police. I think DSP possibly at the level of that should go. But normally what happens is that the person below the rank of what is prescribed goes and inquire. Sometime the trick is being done that the investigation is done by the low rank official, but the high rank official, which is eligible, will sign. So these are kind of bypassing of the rule. Avoiding registration under the relevant section of POA, very interesting table. You must read from the ESDA study that the police officer, the administration, registered the case in those clauses of Prevention of Atrocity Act which involve less punishment or combined with IPC. For some time, IPC alone, you know that, Khali Khair Lange's case. Whole debate was that it was not registered in the beginning under Atrocity Acts, or the Vemula's case. A lot of opposition for registration. Finally, it has been, some sort of thing has been done. So, the administration will deliberately register the case under the clauses which has mild punishment. Late arrest of the accused, or there is a group of people involved in the arrest, You arrest one person, leave the others. Another then put the pressure on the victims. Bring pressure and do all kind of activities. They won't arrest all of them. Delay in filing the charge sheet. This is the point which the Inspector General of the Police in their report, I hope you have read, that in reply to the allegation that there are false cases registered by the Dalit, the Inspector General of the Police came with a report submitted to the government of Maharashtra that there is no evidence whatsoever that Dalit register false cases. They say that there is already a provision in the rules that if there is insufficient evidence, they take out those cases. And about they gave the figure that 5 to 6% of the registered cases are already taken out by the police, and 95% cases which the police consider to be reliable are then registered. So there is no issue of registering false cases. The allegations are not based on the facts, in fact. But that filing is also very, very late, and the Inspector General of the Police came with the conclusion that the incident happened now and the case is filed after 6 months or 7 months. There is a difference in the statement given by the victim at the time of filing the fire and then in the court, and that itself is good enough for acquittal, because these poor people who are harassed do not remember what they had said in the beginning and what they had said now. In fact, Inspector General of the Police came with a recommendation that they are going to run the mock court now. Before a final case is come for hearing, they will teach the accused, the victim, how what they wrote in the FIR and what should they speak in the court. Now, so all kind of complications come because of delays in filing. Untimely and inadequate relief, I won't go into that case issue in greater detail, and high pending rates. 80%, 60% of the cases are pending. Now, let me come to the major issue now. The debate in Maharashtra, in the newspaper, is that there is a low conviction in Maharashtra, and there is a group of people who are arguing that this low conviction is there because false cases are being registered. So high acquittal rate or low conviction rate is low because the false cases are registered. Therefore, large number of people, say 94% of the cases are just acquittal. So here is a statistic. You can see that during 2001 to 2013, the conviction rate is the lowest in Maharashtra. It varies from 1.8 to 8.2%, and annual average is 4.7. So in Maharashtra, of the total cases registered by the Dalit with the police, only 4% or 5% are convicted, which means 95% are acquitted. And the argument is then put forth by a group of people that since the 95% are acquitted, it means the cases are false. Now look at the national average. National average conviction rate is 30%. 54% in UP, 46% in Rajasthan, Uttarakhand, 30% in Madhya Pradesh and Jharkhand, and 37% in Chhattisgarh. As against this, Maharashtra is only 6%. Now why the conviction rate is low? Is it because of false cases or it is because of something else? Now this is the question that I am going to answer soon. The reason for the low conviction is the willful negligence by the administration. This is the statement of the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment Parliamentary Committee. I am giving in the beginning before I go for the evidence. What does the report say? The official attempt to dilute the spirit of the act at every stage. Look at the sentence, very strong sentence, at every stage. From non-registration of the case, failure to investigate according to due process of law, not filling the charge sheet in court within the stipulated time, not giving relief and compensation to the victim, not providing protective and preventive measure, etc. Friends, this is not my conclusion. This is the finding of the parliamentary committee, which is a statutory committee. After surveying all this act and moving around the country, that this is the conclusion that they have, this is the reason that they have given for a low conviction rate. And I believe I am providing you now evidence and facts as to how this committee is correct. And in Maharashtra, if the conviction rate is 5%, it is not because that the Dalit filed the false cases. There is no evidence whatsoever about that. It is because of the willful negligence by the administration to provide a safeguard to the people of their social belonging. That's the conclusion. Look at one by one. The willful negligence means you keep the loopholes in the filing of the cases, and those loopholes are carried to the court and the court make use of it. And on large amount of cases, 95% of the cases are acquitted simply because on the procedural ground, not on the substance of the case, procedural ground, that the visit was not made in this period, that the case was not filed in a specified period. So all procedural grounds are used for an acquittal. Late registration of a fire is the reason for acquittal, imagine. Forget about the case. Delay in spot investigation is considered as a reason by the court. Appointment of an officer below the rank, if they discovered that the case was investigated by the officer below the rank, which is prescribed in the law, it is acquitted. Avoiding to mention caste background. You know, sometimes they deliberately do the administration. You have to mention the caste of the person who is a victim, scheduled caste, another is a high caste. It is in the rule that the accused should be from the high caste and the victim should be from the scheduled caste. Then it can be a case which is under the Atrocity Act. On purpose, the name of the caste of the victim is not given. Sometime of accused not given, the case falls in the court. Straightforward. Late arrest. One arrest leaving other, and what happened? Then there are counter cases by the high caste against the same person. The high caste would file a counter case against the victim to terrorize him or her. And what are those cases generally? The report brings out, these are the cases related to gender violence. The Dalit has indulged into a gender violence, sexual violence. And both the cases are then heard. Same court possibly heard both the cases and the atrocity case is weaker. Now these are the reason for the low conviction rate. And what committee has said is that much of the blame goes to the administrator, much of the blame goes to the bureaucracy. I have a wonderful statement by Dr. Ambedkar, not here but in the paper, that he had said that how bureaucracy behaves and how administration behaves as far as the untouchable and Dalit are concerned. So conviction rate is low because of willful negligence by the official, resulting into high acquittal on procedural ground and not false cases, as has been argued by here. The IG police report mentioned only delay in filing charge sheet as a reason. This is the limitation of the IG report also. Only reason is given is the delay in filing in charge sheet, and there is a difference of opinion. There is a difference in the first statement and the last statement. They observed that only 5 to 6% of the cases they eliminate at the source. 90% of the cases they think are based on the evidence. But this is only one reason. Difference in the statement in the beginning and the end is the one reason. There are many other reasons, and prime reason is the willful negligence and counter-pressure by the accused. So crux of the matter is the working of the government administration. Now let me come. This is what the story which emerges on the basis of the facts. Now the another argument is made that assuming that large majority of the cases are registered in a false way, then it is argued that Atrocity Act should be amended and a provision should be made in that very act that if somebody, some Dalit, registered the false case, he or she should be made punishable offense. Now is this suggestion justifiable on legal and the moral ground? In my opinion, it is not justifiable on any of the ground as a matter of fact. Now let me share with you, again government, because I might say that I am interpreting myself. When the Atrocity Act came for an amendment, it goes to the Standing Committee of the Parliament, which is attached to the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment in Delhi. And that committee really is given the job of looking into the amended act, the suggestion which are made to amend the Atrocity Act, which was amended, approved by the Parliament in 2015, but a year prior to that, the whole process was started, and Parliamentary Committee is the key body which gives the recommendation. This parliamentary committee asked the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment in Delhi. Let me repeat. The parliamentary committee member asked the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment that we have received complaint that of false cases, therefore there should be a provision in the act for the punishment against those who register the false cases. This is the reply of the ministry. And I'll read it for you. The object of the POA Act is to prevent the commission of offenses of atrocity against the member of the scheduled caste and the scheduled tribe. It would thus not be in consonant with the intent of the POA Act to provide for a punishment for a member of SC and ST for registering cases falsely. The 11th section of the IPC can, however, be invoked for dealing with the specific false cases. This was the opinion. Ministry refused and advised the parliamentary committee, you cannot provide the provision in the same act. It will nullify the very purpose of providing justice to the victim, and namely the Dalit. But I have looked into the other literature. Legal and moral ground. First is, let us take a moral ground. Who need a protection? Is the accused who is economically and demographically strong enough in a village, in Maharashtra, everywhere, Dalit account about 13% of population, in some 10% of population, in some 7%, in some cases maybe 17-18. Demographically, Dalit are in minority. Economically, they are the most weakest. Of the total household in rural area, 65% are wage laborer, completely dependent on the high caste land-owning communities. Can demographically a community which is in minority and completely dependent on the high caste for a survival will dare to register false cases? We are living in a world of imagination. I'll come to that, what Dr. Ambedkar has to say. So I don't think factually this argument is correct. But morally, who needs the protection? Protection is needed. Additional protection is needed. Morality demands that the protection is given to the weak and not to the strong. Here the demand is to give the protection to the strong. What is misuse of law in the law? Misuse of law is that the law is not being implemented and it is implemented in favor of those who are in a strong position. That is the misuse. Misuse is not for the accused or the victim. You look at the gender rules and regulation. Gender rules and regulation are so much in favor of women because woman is in a weak position, cannot provide evidence, if it destroy her career. So the law is in her favor. The morality of that favor of law is that you are giving extra protection to the weak. Dalit are so damn weak in the villages. So I don't think in moral ground it is justified, this demand. But on legal ground also, if you take USA, you take Canada, you take Northern Ireland, and you take other countries where South Africa, where a large majority, a section of discriminated group is there, nowhere there is a provision of penalty against the accused, against the victim, in that very law. There are other provisions. I think the ministry has rightly said that you have IPC, go under defamation of act. You have other clauses where the accused, if he thinks that this case is false, you can make use of it. But how can you suggest that the provisions should be in the same very act if there is a provision of punishment for a false registration of the case? No Dalit will dare to even register a case because it will be easy in consonant with the administration, in support with the administration, to prove that the case is false. The evidence shows that 95% of cases are subject to acquittal. So I think this demand is not correct. Let me come to now. Now, I think I have given you the factual story. That untouchability changed, but it persists. There is a violent opposition by the high caste for untouchable seeking the equal right. The number of cases registered. Now, if law has not helped, and even social movement in Maharashtra, despite its leadership, what should be done? I think the law should continue, certainly, but there is a need that we must take certain step. I am extremely happy that Honorable Secretary of Social Justice is here, Director of Balti is here. I think these are some of the suggestions I present before them and present before everybody. What are the present solutions? Let us review the present solution. The present solutions are legal, 2 Act, Untouchability Offence Act and Atrocity Act. Then the measure for economic empowerment. Reservation policy is one of them. That is to give them some space in job, education and politics. Because in a normal course, they won't get it because of discrimination. in job and education and in politics. And the third solution that is used is increase the social awareness again, the untouchability, sensitize people. Now, let me share with you the important things and the limitation of this solution. And that limitation itself is the reason as to why untouchability and atrocity persist. Legal safeguard and their limitation, the law. Now, laws are necessary, but Dr. Ambedkar would argue that laws have their limitation in dealing with the issue of untouchability because of one particular reason. Not that law are not necessary. Now, I'll read this sentence. This is very important. This is again in Ranade Gandhi and Jina. Dr. Ambedkar argued that if individual commit an offense, law is very effective. You file a case against the individual and provide the evidence, the court will take care of it. But if the community as a whole discriminate, then the law fails. Dr. Ambedkar says, prevalent view is that once rights are enacted in the law, that is just like Untouchability Act, then they are safeguarded. This is an unwarranted assumption. Rights are not protected by law, but the social and moral conscience of a society. If social conscience is such that it is recognized the right which law chooses to enact, right will be safe and secured. When the community as a whole practice discrimination, then the law became a less useful instrument. I continue this quotation. But if the fundamental rights are opposed by the community, this is Dr. Ambedkar, and look at the sentence, no law, no parliament, no judiciary can guarantee them in the real sense of the word. And he quotes Brooke, one of the leading philosophers, there is no method found for punishing the multitude, means many, if they practice discrimination. Law can punish a single solitary criminal, as I said. It can never operate against an whole body of people who are determined to defy it. That is what is happening in Maharashtra. A whole body of people practice discrimination in a village for several years. And that is why law fails. Law cannot be an useful instrument, however necessary it is, useful instrument when the community as a whole practice discrimination. And therefore, Dr. Ambedkar says, social conscience is the only safeguard of all the right, fundamental or non-fundamental. Now, we have to recognize the limitation of this law and therefore take the decisions. Now, let me come and discuss what is social conscience. Now, social conscience is nothing but these are moral principles which tells you what is wrong and what is right. And you then follow the right. Now, social conscience, if your social conscience and your thinking, your norms and principle of your behavior, if they are supportive of equality, liberty, fraternity and equality, fraternity, then it will be possible to give the right to the Dalit. Otherwise not. Now, what are the existing provisions? Existing provision is that the Constitution provides for a social justice, equality, liberty, freedom and fraternity to everybody. But world one, which has persisting norms and customs, they support inequality, antisocial attitude and unfreedom. You know that individual liberty is being challenged in wearing of cloth, in selecting your partners. Constitution guarantee you the liberty and individual freedom. In practice, this is being opposed. So there is a conflict between the constitutional principle of equality and the world-based caste inequality. World continue and community as a whole. So continuation of the denial of equal right to the untouchable is thus the outcome and the absence of social conscience in favor of the laws supporting of equality. This is the explanation for persistence of untouchability despite law, since whole community denies and law fails. Now this is the crux of the matter. That our social conscience, our behavior in the villages is determined by the law, by the norms and the principle and the custom and the habit and the values which is in favor of inequality. And that evidence I have given to you. Residential segregation, denial of equal right to scheduled caste. So people are not wrong here. I'll come to that later, what Dr. Ambedkar said. People are not wrong And don't blame the people. The norms and principle and the custom which decide their behavior toward the untouchable are wrong. And it is this norm and principle which do not allow them to develop a social conscience in favor of equality. So if you have to have right social conscience, the social reform movement you need there. How do you change the norms and principles which are still supportive of inequality and about which we haven't done? After Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar left for a couple of years, yes, but thereafter the anti-caste movement and anti-untouchability movements is completely on the back seat. There are other instruments that we have used. So social conscience supportive of inequality also draws support from religion. This is what Dr. Ambedkar said. The most difficult part is that you have a racism in USA, but Christianity doesn't support racism in the test. It is a different matter that Christianity follows the colonizer, supported them in a way. So they are equally responsible for the racism and slavery in USA or elsewhere. But if somebody tries on the basis of the religious principle of Christianity, they don't get a support for poverty or they don't get a support for racism. Here, our entire religious philosophy and social philosophy supports caste inequality. Caste is a divine institution created from the part of the bodies of the Brahma. Four castes emerge from the four part of the bodies. It's a divine, godly institution. Now people believe that this is the divine institutions. And therefore, removal of caste and untouchability became extremely stubborn institution, an extremely difficult institution because it has a religious root. That was the difference between Gandhiji and Ambedkar, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Gandhiji would say caste system and untouchability are appendixes of the Hindu religious philosophy. Babasaheb would say no. Caste and untouchability had a philosophical foundation in the hardcore philosophy of Hinduism. You pick up Rigveda, you have Purushutta, which talks about four varna. You pick up Gita, it talks about four varnas. You pick up Ramayana, it talks about caste system. You pick up Mahabharata, it talks about caste system. And forget about the smrutis. You have the classical example of Manusmuti, or you take all other smruti. So the whole literature, there is a chapter by Dr. Ambedkar, Brahminical literature, and read that. The whole literature is there, where every literature supports the social organization, and it is rightly. That is the social system of the Hindus. So there is a religious foundation to the caste system, and that is why it became a lot more difficult. Therefore, what is the agenda? Social agenda should be then to help people to discard inequality supportive norms and principles and transform them into one supportive of equality. Develop social conscience of the people that will be supportive of equality. Law is the key issue for social reform by the government in the state and even for the civil society. Now, the social reform essentially means then how do you transform the norms and principle of the behavior of people which are supportive of inequality? Don't blame the people in rural area. Dr. Ambedkar has a very classical word, sentence. People's actions are the result of the principle that they believe in. And the principle and norms in which the people believe is in support of caste system. So if you want to change, don't blame the people. Change the norms and the principle that guide their behavior. For my institute, I have made a 8-hour documentary going to different places. A young director from there, Bombay, has made this. And he asked everybody, and it come out quite clearly, that rural people are absolutely honest. And they tell about it, that why do we observe the caste system? Now, therefore social reform is the one that I said. Now there is one point I will make and I will stop this issue of reform of this legal system. So far what we have done is, we have provided a safeguard to the victim, that is to the Dalit. Here is the Untouchability Offence Act. If you are stopped, you can make use of that law. Here is the Atrocity Act. If you are attacked violently or otherwise, you can go to the court of law and seek a protection. So law provides you safeguard to have an equal access. Now, Dalit do that. That is how the cases are there. But we haven't done much about the accused. The one who practiced discrimination, the one who used violence, we have not focused on that. We have not realized that he or she is the source of discrimination. And how do we change them? That we have not touched at all. So social reform for changing the behavior has remained in the backward seat. That is why equal focus is necessary on the accused. Those who practice discrimination for a change in their social behavior toward the untouchable. They themselves are victims. Dr. Ambedkar in Annihilation of Caste has clearly said, don't blame the people, blame their norms. Blame the religious ideas, notion which they bring with them and practice discrimination. So they themselves are the victim. People are not essentially by heart wrong. What is wrong is their norms and principle and the religious notion that they carry. So the government has a less engagement with the people who practice untouchability. And I think the social reform movement, my suggestion is, and even Dr. Ambedkar's suggestion, I'm drawing from there. Really, there is nothing much I can add to what Baba Sahib has said, that focus on social reform means change the norms, principle which govern the behavior of the people. And since it has a base in the religious philosophy, please address that aspect also to the extent possible. This is the quotation and I'll end this portion. People are not wrong in observing caste, but their belief in Shastra, which has inculcated this notion of caste. We must grapple not the people, but the ideology, supportive of caste, which induced them to follow caste, annihilation of caste. The real remedy is to destroy this belief, which continue to mold the belief and action of the people. The act of the people are merely the result of their belief, inculcated upon their mind, and that people will not change their conduct unless they cease to believe in the religion of caste. That is the crux of social reform, which we have, after mid-60s, 70s, we have really forgotten. Now let me come to the one more point and then I will stop. What is discrimination? Discrimination is an idea. An idea is being created that the people are created by the God into four classes, and each one has got some rights, and those rights are unequally distributed, and untouchable do not have right. Right to property, right to education, and no civic right. This is an idea which was put into practice. So you attack the idea. When I say social reform, you really criticize the idea. But that's not enough. The reason is, besides ideas and principle, economic power matters. There is economic foundation to the ideas. There is economic power with the high caste, which enable them to discriminate. So motive, let us see what is the motive behind the discrimination or denial of equal right. The motive is, of course, a high social status, but motive is also economic. All sources of income, asset, land, enterprises, education, employment should be with us and not with them. In the test, I'm not talking of the present day reality, in the test it is clearly mentioned. Now why is it that those rules are formed? That I will have all economic right and you won't have? It's fine that you can have that, I should have an economic right, but why do you deny to others? And why you put even punishment if you try to take land or if you try to have an access to education? Why do we make that provision? The intention is quite clear. The intention is that we should have maximum economic power so that we enjoy it, and we can only enjoy it at the cost of others. If others do not have, then we will have. If others have, our share gets reduced. Now that is why both denial, both civic right and economic right, and particularly to untouchable, there is no property and education. Which means that the caste discrimination has economic foundation, remember well. Along with the change of ideas, what we require is the change of the economic foundation of the caste system. And that is what Dr. Ambedkar did. Reservation was one of the reasons. Give them job, give them education, give them share in the politics. So economic empowerment of Dalit is very, very important, because the caste discrimination foundation is also not only in ideas but also in economics. Now let me bring you the experience of other countries as to how economic power is the foundation of discrimination. There is a rampant discrimination, there was, and they continue to be there in USA and other countries. But USA is the only country where they developed the theories of discrimination. These are all Nobel laureate. Baker in 1956 produced a book, Economic Discrimination. And there he talked of discrimination of race and gender. Chicago University refused to publish the book of Baker. Finally, he managed to publish the book from Chicago University and he got a Nobel Prize for that book. The world knows about it. Arrow, another Nobel laureate, he developed economic theory of discrimination. Akerlof, who is still alive, he developed a theory of discrimination. Bloomer, Darity, African-American economists. What is the sum of their argument? The sum of their argument, which can be applied very, which Dr. Ambedkar has very easily applied. He didn't read this. These are the theories developed in the 60s and the 70s when Dr. Ambedkar was no more, but his theories are almost similar to that of these people. What is the motive behind the discrimination? The motive behind discrimination is economic power, economic greed. And that is land, that is industry, that is capital, that is education. And Dalit will not have anything. I hope you have read that famous prescription by Manu, that the only job of the untouchable, Shudra's word at that time, only job of Shudra is to serve the high caste. And among the high caste, the best thing for them would be that they serve the Brahmin. They cannot accumulate wealth, they cannot have access to education. I am literally quoting from Manusmriti. Why? Why should somebody make this provision and take all the power to ourselves? The reason is the economic motive. Now, all this economic theory based on race, gender, why is it that the male are opposing the reservation to the woman in parliament? Very slowly. They constitute 52% of the state population, India's population, and they are only 10% in the parliament. They are asking, let us give at least 30%. They are not willing, very reluctant. The reason is because we will lose our seat. So it's a question of give and take. And discrimination here is beside the social status, and develop an idea is also for the economic motive. Now, therefore, this makes very, very difficult for the Dalit to seek the justice. Let me finally finish with this before I come to the suggestion, that if economic motive is the power of continuing discrimination, then what is the situation in the villages? The situation in the villages is such that the Dalit cannot afford to get us justice. Very slow speed. Most of the atrocity happen in the villages. The economic and demographic imbalances in the villages is such that the Dalit cannot access the equal right. What are the economic imbalances? I'll give the statistic later, but let us look at the foresight of Dr. Ambedkar. In state and minorities, he said, and let me read for you, that the Hindus most often succeed in suppressing the untouchable in villages is due to many causes. The chief weapon in the armory of Hindu is the economic power which they possess over the poor untouchable living in the villages. How true he is. It is a fight between economically and demographically weak Dalit and strong high caste. 15% of Dalit, 70% of high caste. 65% of Dalit who are wage laborer, and most of the landowner are high caste. The fight is between the very two, strong and weak. Now what Dr. Ambedkar described in 1946, even today, is true. In rural area in Maharashtra, I look at the figure, the Dalit account 15% of the population. Buddhist and, if you take Buddhist, Scheduled Caste Buddhist and the Hindu Scheduled Caste, it's about 15%. While the population of high caste in the village is 75%. Economically, in 2012, of the total household of Dalit, 60% of Dalits are wage laborer dependent on high caste for livelihood. How can they fight? To say that they can file false cases is something which nobody can understand. Economically, demographically, extremely weak group cannot fight and cannot get. Therefore, their struggle have been suppressed. There are series of incidences in Maharashtra where there is a violent attack against the Dalit. You know, renaming of Marathwada University, what happened in Marathwada. So, what Ambedkar says is, we remain true, that in the village, because of the imbalance in demography and economics, it's difficult for Dalit to get the right And therefore he suggested this. I'll elaborate later on now in last 15 minutes. Therefore he suggested separate villages with an independent means of livelihood. Now let me come some of my thinking, and I want to share with you what we additionally should try to do to at least minimize, if not eliminate untouchability and atrocity. The first thing that I think government of Maharashtra should do is to give a top priority to the eradication of untouchability. At the moment, the issue of untouchability is very much less on the agenda of the government. There are little campaign, that's all. But beyond that, like a poverty, untouchability, from which I think 15% of Dalit, of course, suffer, but 27% of OBC to a certain extent suffer in some areas. It has to be brought on the priority. Poverty is, of course, a daily hunger and lack of food. But untouchability is a day-to-day humiliation of the 15% of the population. The statistics show you only part of the story, but day-to-day experiences of humiliation and denial of right. So untouchability will have to be taken, has to be taken a highest priority. Second, we do not know. We have a scheduled caste commission, and you ask them, what is the status of untouchability? They have nothing to offer. I asked the chairman of the SC commission, and he sent me the district-wise number of cases registered by Dalit. That's all. The studies that I have quoted to you, 7-8 studies, these are by the private organization. The Atrocity Act in India requires the state to conduct the regular survey to know the status of untouchability every 5 years. Not a single survey, to my knowledge, I should be corrected by the government office. Not a single survey has been conducted regularly of the untouchability in the villages, so that we know that untouchability has reduced in this sphere, but it persists in this sphere. So let us focus on this. But no surveys, because it's not on priority. Priority on priority is something else. Now, of course, effective implementation of the PCR and PO, Protection of Atrocity Act, I don't want to spend on that time. All those limitations that I have mentioned will have to be overcome. I think the state government required to set up a committee and look into the working of the Atrocity Act and come with the proposal whereby how we can implement the act effectively. There are ways which we can do. I have certain ways. I have certain suggestion, but this is not the time. But I think we can minimize those limitations in the implementation of the prevention of the Atrocity Act. But we also need the approach that is followed by the South Africa, healing and reconciliation. You know, as Baba Sahib has rightly said, that law is helpful to the individual criminal. You can punish him. Now, here is 70% of the community in the villages which practice discrimination against the Dalit, who are isolated, separated. And on a day-to-day basis, there is a tension. There has to be dialogue. If the high caste are victim of their own ideology and deny and commit atrocity on Dalit, I think they themselves suffer. Therefore, what South Africa has done is to board the people together. Whenever something happens, they bring the people together and make them to talk that how some are wrongs, confess their mind, introspect. That is how they have done. That's how Mandela could bring the black government in South Africa. But it was through reconciliation. I think the government has to use this remedy also. Law, yes. But reconciliation, bringing the people together, talking to them that, look, this is what constitution say, this is what you are practicing. Change it to the extent possible. Don't do it. If you have a problem, here is a law, here is a discussion, here is a panchayat office where you can discuss, but don't use atrocity. I think some program will have to be developed by the government. I think the responsibility of enforcing the Untouchability Act is to some extent on the villages, but I think more responsibility is necessary to give the panchayat. It is the village which is the stage where atrocity happens, where the everything happens and discrimination prevails. I am not talking of rural discrimination in the bureaucracy, in discrimination in the employment, in the government jobs. That's another area. The urban scene is quite different. Nobody has studied. We need a lot of things there. You have seen the decision of the High Court yesterday. They have discontinued the reservation in promotion, not realizing that there is a whole lot of discrimination that the Dalit face in bureaucracy. So urban area is completely different. We will see that later. But I'm talking of rural, that panchayat is an institution at the village level which should be made use of. Those who are representative, high caste representative, should be told that, look, in your village, there should not be an untouchability in a public sphere. That if there is a possibility and potential of the atrocity and violence, please take care of it. Solve through discussion. An untouchable boy and a high caste girl, when they have some relationship for marriage or for whatever reason, and you see a potential, it is here that the panchayat should intervene. Bring the parents of the boy and parents of the girl and village and sit and solve the issue amicably. That is reconciliation. So the panchayat should be given the responsibility. At the moment, there is nothing much at the panchayat level. There are two more drastic suggestions. These are not mine, these are Dr. Ambedkar's. And this is separate settlement of the untouchable to begin with. Dr. Ambedkar, through his rigorous academic analysis, came to the conclusion that in the village setting, where untouchables are less in number and dependent on high caste, economically, there is no chance that untouchable will get this equal access. Therefore, he suggested separate villages for the Dalit with an independent source of income. So he want disconnect, geographical and economic disconnect between the high caste and the low caste. There is a whole lot of discussion, and he repeated 3 times, remember well. He repeated in a paper that he submitted to the specific conference, published as Gandhiji and Untouchable, and repeated in the state and minority. And in state and minority, there is a whole justification as to why he is asking for separate villages. In fact, he went to the extent of saying that, I may be blamed as a separatist, but if this suggestion is not accepted, what you will have is the slavery. And that is what precisely happening in the villages in Maharashtra. For last 30, 40 years, untouchability, atrocity continues because his analysis is right. Something must be done. I think Maharashtra government can start off separate settlement, at least for those villages where the population of scheduled caste is small and that the taluka and the district is prone to atrocities. So some step will have to be taken. The most important which Dr. Ambedkar has suggested is the following. That is 10-year program to settle the Dalit in the cities and town. If you look at the economic theory of Dr. Ambedkar, he emphasized on industrialization and urbanization, migration of the Dalit from the rural to the urban areas. Because in urban area, there might be a discrimination, but there is no violence. There is no day-to-day humiliation and condemnation. And therefore, he favored the shifting of Dalit from the rural to urban area. I think I have a feeling, my suggestion is that this the government should try, that gradually over a period of 10 to 15 years, if there can be a plan of shifting Dalit to the cities so that that geographical and economic disconnect happen. Now this is not impossible, this is possible. Dalit face immense pain, remember well, in the village. Our notions are such that we don't mind inequality at all. We don't talk about that. Do we discuss that in all the villages, untouchable live separately? There's a residential segregation. We don't mind it at all. That is our notion, that those are our values about which we are not sensitive at all. Therefore, you place them in an atmosphere where there won't be a day-to-day humiliation. We did that experiment. At the time of partition of Pakistan, we brought all people, Hindus from Pakistan, give them the land, give them the money. 30,000 rupees, here is a plot of land, it's up to you. Dr. Ambedkar is not suggesting which is something is not practicable. But if you want to free untouchable from day-to-day humiliation, I think his suggestion, these are not my suggestion. Remember well, these are Dr. Ambedkar's suggestion in state and minorities. And I am only reinterpreting on the basis of the last 30 years, 35 experience, that how correct he was in his analysis of the problem. The program of economic empowerment is another thing. That he, at least for the new settler in the cities, you have to have a public employment program. Now, this government, the Honorable Prime Minister, has announced the mega housing scheme. Let us plan that in each district and each taluka. When I'm talking of urbanization, I'm not talking of Bombay. There are 576 towns, small, big, and large town. The towns are of 5 categories. 557 or so. So plan the shifting and settlement of Dalit in those every town. Give them the land, give them the money. They will put their money and they will have their own settlement. But plan some jobs, public employment, so that they have an independent source of income and a separate existence. There are a lot many things which I am not sharing with you. If this is the animosity between the two groups in Maharashtra now happening, imagine the economic discrimination of the Dalit. Will they get the job in the factories owned by this group? Imagine. The unemployment rate in Maharashtra is about 4 to 5% at the state level. The unemployment rate of the scheduled caste is 13%. 4 to 5 times higher, based on 2011 and 12 unemployment report, national sample survey. OBC is 6%, Muslim is less. But untouchable is 13-14%. In fact, in the age group of 15 to 29, it is 16%. Why? Because they face discrimination in jobs. If this kind of animosity and social conflict, who will give them the job? So the best remedy is to throw them into the urban area, give them the housing, give them some money, let them start business, but provide public employment to them. Now the last one I will add is that we still need an education program against untouchability and caste discrimination by the state. This state has to do the program of education to adopt, to promote moral principle which support equality. What need to be changed? The need to be changed is belief in norm which are supportive of untouchability. Belief in community level policing with punishment, shockingly cruel and inhuman. Now, we are aghast. We are silent. The kind of atrocities and physical violence going on, community level violence. Una, the lynching of the boys, you cannot imagine. Saharanpur. Now if you see the video that is being circulated now, I don't have a courage to share with you, but I will share with you. Under the moral policing, the couple is caught sitting together. Both of them paraded naked, boy and a girl. The boy is asked to take the girl on his shoulder. He did that for half a furlong, collapse on the ground. Then girl is asked to carry the boy. So we are not paying attention to this. Why our society is behaving like this? Why it is shockingly cruel and inhuman, which the Supreme Court said? The reason is the following. Again, people are not wrong. But the moral and the norms based on Manusmuti and not on constitution is the reason. In my article, I have given the entire punishment that have been suggested by Manu. Physical punishment. And the punishment that untouchable face now, there is a close similarity. So people are not wrong. What they are doing is what their shastras are telling, teach them. The instrument of enforcement of caste is the following. This is in Manusmuti. And that is called, in sociology, it is called social ostracism. That is economic and social boycott and exclusion. That is the instrument. And this is not only for untouchable, this is for the community people also. In Haryana, you know that. A particular high caste girls, if marry a Dalit, that family of high caste is excommunicated. That is the instrument which is prescribed in Manusmriti. And of course for Dalit it is economic and social boycott. It is going on in Marathwada for last 4 months. It is going on in Andhra Pradesh for last 4 months. There are the village people who are sitting in the Jantar Mantar in Delhi. Now the point that I wanted to convey and emphasize against on you is this, that the community level violent action and policing, it's a policing, is something which people do because it is mentioned in the Manusmriti, and it is in their subconscious mind that this is what we have done, dandaniti. The community can do it. Otherwise, why they are doing? They are not imagining the solutions on their own, because this has been written in the test and it is passed on. It's the legacy of the past which is spill over to the present and implemented by the youth. Now, you will have to teach this through education. Education is an instrument. America is doing, let me tell you. I don't have a time. for higher education and school education. Their argument is that with 99% student going to the first class, enrollment ratio in the school education is about 99-98%. In our state also is very high, 89%. If all the boys goes to the school, remain there for 4 years, that is the laboratory where you can change his thought, sensitize him. Part of them go to higher secondary, part of them go to higher education. So educational can be used to change the norms and values of the student, because their norms and values are taught in the family and society, which are in support of inequality. What we do? Moral principles, NCC. Beyond that we don't go. We don't face the reality. We don't tell them. America has introduced a course in colleges which is compulsory for every undergraduate and postgraduate. And that course talk about racial discrimination, inequalities, sexual orientation, classism of Anglo-Saxons. All kind of poverty, inequality and discrimination are being taught. I brought the book from Massachusetts University. So education is being used as an instrument of social change of youth, so that next generation will not be like the present. Now I end with this, friends, with Dr. Ambedkar's vision that we are talking of nation today, nowadays very, very, very strongly. What should be nation? Some are dubbed as anti-national, some are dubbed as national. So that has come now. Ambedkar's thoughts on Pakistan, where he discussed the concept of nation. Denying equal right, practicing untouchability, is denying citizenship to a whole lot of people. Citizenship is nothing but enjoyment of certain fundamental right. And to the extent that the untouchability and caste discrimination deny right, you are not a citizen. And nation can be strong provided you are a citizen. Now Dr. Ambedkar talks about inclusive nation, developing citizenship. Let me read for you, because it's very difficult to summarize, but therefore I am giving you. The point is that nationality is not primarily a matter of geography, culture or language. That is what nation is defined today. Nation is not a physical thing in which certain objective characteristics such as commonality of language, race, territory persist. This is not the definition. This doesn't make us nation. Even if you have one religion, one culture, one language, one race, you can't become a nation. Nation, on the contrary, is a spiritual reality, binding people into a deep comradeship. Ambedkar's word. Nationality is a social feeling of corporate sentiment of oneness. It is a feeling of consciousness of a kind, like-mindedness. Possessing things in common, in communication, in life of communication, participation and sharing with all those who constitute a nation, sharing their pain and sorrow. In this sense, nation is a society where there is an unlimited scope for social endosmosis. Endosmosis means everybody is involved, everybody is together, everybody share joy and pain of everybody. Nation is a democracy, a mode of associated living, of conjoined communicated experience. So, communication, participation and sharing with all those who constitute one nation is the key thing for a nation. Today, Dalit, Adivasi, nomadic, denominated tribe, woman, religious minority in Maharashtra face unequal treatment. We have to recognize that we are still a nation in making. We are not a nation insofar as a large section of the people do not enjoy citizenship right. We are still a nation in making. We are a democracy in making. Dalits are citizen in making. They are not complete citizens. Lot more effort are needed to make the Dalit, Adivasi, woman, and nomadic tribe, denotified tribe. Denotified tribe face discrimination of criminal stigma. I just finished a survey on them. Religious minorities, you know that, I need not spell out. This all requires citizenship right, then we will have an inclusive nation in the eyes of Dr. Ambedkar. The resolve to do that will be a great tribute to legacy of Asgharli engineer. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you very much, Professor Thorat, for delivering a very erudite lecture, pointing out that untouchability is increasing, roots of untouchability, and also solutions, some of the solutions to untouchability. Let me say that till at least 2019, none of these solutions are even thinkable. But if we all resolve, I don't know about everybody outside, but if all of us sitting in this hall resolve to these principles of citizenship, we can make a big difference in realizing the preamble of our constitution, social justice. Friends, we don't have much time and I'll not take up any more. I very heartily welcome our chair today, Sri Dinesh Vaghmare Sahib. It is my pleasant duty to introduce Vaghmare Sahib. Sri Dinesh Vaghmare has an extensive and enriching career of over 23 years in Indian Administrative Services. He joined IAS Maharashtra cadre in 1994 and recently completed his tenure as the Civic Chief of Pimpri Chinchwad Municipal Corporation. Sri Vaghmare Sahib has had an unconventional career path. He is a technologist with a BE in electrical engineering and a postgraduate in computer science from IIT Kharagpur. Influenced by his friends, he took up civil services exam in 1994 and joined IAS as an officer. Throughout his career, he has been Secretary, Special Justice and Social Assistance of the Maharashtra Government, Managing Director, Maharashtra Agro Industries Development Corporation, as well as Municipal Commissioner of Navi Mumbai Municipal Corporation. Throughout his life, he has initiated and implemented various solutions and received many accolades for that. In 2014, he received the Satyen Moitra National Award for Best Implementation of Post-Literacy Mission from Honorable Vice President of India. Let us heartily welcome our chair. We know that in spite of his really busy schedule, when I invited him to chair this lecture, he readily agreed. In spite of his, and in midst of meeting that he had in Mantralaya, he has made all the efforts to be here with us and chair this session. I invite him, first of all, I invite Sandhya Mahatre to honor Sri Dinesh Vaghmare. I invite Vaghmare Sahib to deliver his remarks as a chair.
In this Dr. Asghar Ali Engineer Memorial Lecture organized by Center for Study for Society and Secularism, Professor Sukhdeo Thorat ji, Advocate Irfan Engineer ji, and all dignitaries present for this memorial lecture. First, I would like to thank Professor Sukhdeo ji Thorat for giving such excellent, outstanding lecture on the topic which is very so near to his heart. Actually, I'm also very much sorry that I was not able to attend this memorial lecture right from the beginning because of certain assignments in Mantralaya. Actually, this subject of untouchability and implementation of Prevention of Atrocities Act, our department as a Social Justice and Special Assistance Department actually monitors the implementation of this act. Along with the police department, and there are several other entities like Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe Commission, and also Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Research and Training Institute. In fact, if you see the overall scenario of implementation of Prevention of Atrocities Act, the one most concern, particularly for Maharashtra, which comes is that the conviction rate, as far as the conviction rates are concerned, in Maharashtra, conviction rate is very low as compared to other states. And in fact, if we compare the number of cases filed in Maharashtra as compared to other states, similar states like Karnataka or Andhra Pradesh, it's more or less similar. And in fact, the number of cases filed also actually hovers around 1,500 to 2,000 cases per year. Like in 2011, 1,469 cases were filed. After that, 1,407, then 2,068, and 2,191, and lately, 1,862. So it's around 1,500 to 2,000 cases are filed every year. And as far as the bifurcation of crime is concerned, I think the most number of crimes falls into other category. And in fact, like some of the major crime, like if you consider murder, it is, if you take a particular typical figure of 1 year, murder it is 52, then Gambhir Dukhapat is 124, rape 241, Javo 35, Dangal 236, Vinay Bhanga 341, Padun Nene 67, Jabri Chori 30, Daroda 40. So almost this also actually, this pattern is also more or less similar every year. So there is hardly any change. But then if you consider the pendency of the cases, in fact, as far as the Maharashtra is concerned, pendency as compared to other state is very high. In fact, today's pendency, if you see, it's almost around 9,500 cases are pending as of date. And if you consider the figures, conviction figures of last year, only in 55 cases order for conviction was passed, and almost 332 cases were acquitted. So we need to actually think about what exactly is the cause. Professor Sukhdeo Thorat ji has elaborated very in detail the total analysis of exactly what is happening. But if you can see also the demographic distribution of these cases, so you can sort of there is some relation, like the most number of convictions are happening in Uttar Pradesh. In fact, I am taking your figures only. Uttar Pradesh is 52.3% cases, and Rajasthan it is 40%. They are almost on top of the list. But you consider Karnataka, which is our nearby state, the conviction rate is 3.7%, is much lower than Maharashtra. Even if you take like Kerala, the conviction rate is 7%. And Gujarat, it is 4%. Maharashtra is 6%. So I think there seems to be the more backward the state is, the more number of conviction rate is there. and more advanced economically or otherwise state is there, conviction rates are low. So this particular correlation we need to study further. So why it is happening ki in advanced state the conviction rate is low, and why in backward state like Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan, even Chhattisgarh, where the conviction rate is 36%. So these are basically traditionally North Indian state, particularly Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, where conviction rate is very, very high. Another interesting, once again, I'm getting statistics from Professor Thorat's report only. If you consider subcaste-wise, actually victim percentage. Subcaste-wise victim percentage, if you see, then in Maharashtra, Maharas are most of the victims are from Mahar. So almost 59% of victims are from Mahar community. And Matang, if you take Matang, 27%. And Chambhar, if you take, they are hardly 5% cases. Hardly 5% of victims are from Chambhar. And the communities which are actually committing atrocities, they are like Marathas with 44%, then Vanjari. Vanjari actually is a backward, is included in nomadic tribes and Vimukta Jati. So they are a sort of a kind of Dalits to us also. So Vanjari is just Vanjari actually, they commit atrocities of 5, and their percentage is 5.47%. Interestingly, Muslims commit atrocities, almost 10% of Muslims, they commit atrocities on SCs and STs. And if you consider tribals in Maharashtra, atrocity committed on tribal is almost negligible. If you consider Bhil tribal is 1.9%, and if you consider Mahadev Koli, they are 0.7%. Only these two tribes, some atrocities are committed, and that also on very, very low side. I think these actually figure also we have to study, and what exactly, why Mahars are being targeted so much. Almost 60% of cases are happening against Mahar. I think there has to be some connect between political organization or some sort of political unity. And in fact, the society has to come up with some robust organization which actually works for, in fact, pre-commitment of atrocities as well as post-commitment of atrocity. Society should come up with, society and civil society should come up with some kind of sound organization which actually works in this field. Another thing is that, like, of course, in fact, we are taking regular review with the police department, and also there is a state level committee. There is a district level committee under collector of every district where meetings are conducted regularly, and also divisional level meetings are also there. Divisional level vigilance committee is there, which is headed by a divisional commissioner. So those meetings, of course, the frequency of those meetings may be little less than the district level meetings, but then those meetings are also conducted regularly. But actually, in fact, despite all this, Maharashtra government should, I also think that should give more priority towards effective implementation of Prevention of Atrocities Act. And there are a lot of grounds we need to study further about the low conviction rate. There might be something like procedural lacunas might be there, like appropriate authority is not investigating the crime, and then FIR has not been lodged on time, charge sheet is not filed on time. So these are actually the procedure now which can definitely be corrected. But there are substantial causes like the witness and the victims actually, in fact, going against the case in courts. As far as speedy disposal of cases, government has started 6 special courts. And out of these 6 special courts, 3 special courts has already started functioning, mainly in Mumbai, Aurangabad, and Thane. These special courts have already started functioning. And in fact, another 3 places, Nashik, Pune, and Amravati, we will soon be starting the special courts. In other district places, the district court has been designated as a special court in those places, but they are also trying other kind of cases. So we are doing our level best to speedy recovery of these cases, and in fact, Honorable CM sir is also going to take one meeting regarding this. I think the awareness part is also most important, like Professor Thorat ji said, like education against atrocity has to be in fact strengthened, and we have got a institution in Maharashtra, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar Research and Training Institute. Mr. Rajesh Dhabre, who is Director General of the Institute, is present here. So we need to conduct more awareness campaign and more workshops. In fact, police department also has to be sensitized as far as the implementation of this act is concerned. One thing actually in the rural area which I observe, like in fact, wherever there is a urban migration from rural area, so in urban area the prevention of atrocity is much lesser. The atrocity cases mostly happens. I actually gave you figure overall India. We state the atrocity cases are higher on the higher side, but within Maharashtra also, if you see the atrocity cases, the most of the atrocity cases happen in the backward region of Maharashtra. Like if you take Marathwada and Vidarbha, and in fact some part of western Maharashtra, although it is not basically backward, but then predominantly agriculture area. So wherever the areas are economically backward and predominantly agriculture, so there atrocities cases are happening mostly. And in fact, like what Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar said, that they should be shift from urban, from rural area, like Dalit communities should basically, should be migrated to urban area where the prevention of atrocity is much, much lower, and then need, there is need to resettle and rehabilitate them in urban areas. And most of the scheduled caste families which come to urban area, they live in slum. Although they live in slum, they have much better life. So actually they earn more, and also social discrimination is much lesser. So definitely, in fact, whatever the recommendations of Professor Sukhdeo Thorat, and also recommendation of various civil societies, the government of Maharashtra will definitely make a plan to spread awareness among people against atrocities, and also make an action plan for speedy disposal of pending cases. Thank you much.
Thank you very much, Sri Vaghmare Sahib, for delivering your comments as chair on the lecture. Friends, I want to announce here one or two things. One, this lecture will be published in Indian Journal of Secularism. Some very limited copies of this lecture is available today. Very limited copies are available today. We didn't have sufficient time to publish it, but we'll be publishing it in Indian Journal of Secularism. You can get your copy of Indian Journal of Secularism as and when it's published. We'll advertise. We'll let you know in the next forthcoming issue. Center also publishes certain e-digests. We have published e-digests which we circulate on email and also make it available on our website. Besides many other publications, I'm not reading all the publications for shortage of time. One or two e-digests that I would like to inform you, and which is available on our website, is Gandhi's Assassination, Godse and RSS Connection. Another e-digest is Ambedkar's Appropriation by Hindutva Ideology. The third e-digest is Native Terror Factories. You must have got some of these e-digests through email, those of you who are on email lists. Those who are not getting our information through email, kindly write down your email to us. We will add to our mailing list so that you get all this. Our website address is, those who want to note down, CSSS, very simple, Center for Study of Society and Secularism, CSSS hyphen ISLA, ISLA.com. CSSS hyphen ISLA.com. With this, I wish there was more. Sometimes we allow question and answers, and sometimes memorial lectures do not have question and answers. I wish we had more time, we would have allowed some question and answers, but we can continue our discussion outside. I invite Dr. Ritu Diwan, Executive Director, Center for Study of Society and Secularism, to give a vote of thanks.
I really wish we had more time, because there's a lot of debate which is going on, and there's a lot more to hear and a lot more to learn and probably to say also. But we have to finish here. First of all, of course, Sri Vagmare, we are really very, very happy that you came here, and I think with the kind of work you have done on these kinds of issues and the fact that you have, I think, right now the right to do much more as heading the department. So a special appeal to you to take a lot of the issues forward, what has been raised by Professor Thorat. And I assure you that the center will provide full support, whether it's in terms of workshops or research on some of the areas which have been mentioned. So thank you very, very much for that. Professor Thorat belongs to that very maligned group of which I'm also a part, called an economist. But I think an economist, what we all know, is basically, I mean, an economist is really a social scientist. And I think there can't be any better illustration of somebody who uses science, a scientific method, to understand what society is doing. So I really thank you very much for the issues which you have raised. And also, as all of you know, he was chairperson of ICSSR, Indian Council for Social Science Research, and supported us and many movements of the marginalized for a very long period of time, including the Indian Journal of Secularism, which CSSS, which our center brings out. And I must inform you that within 2 weeks of your leaving, we got a letter saying that the funding to the journal has been stopped. So that is one, an immediate, one can understand the context of what has happened. Another, when he was the chairperson of UGC, he was one of the greatest supporters of our women's studies centers. And we've set up now 163 centers, 163 universities. But again, very sad to say, 2 months ago we got a circular saying 30th of September is the last date of the existence of the women's studies centers. So that's another, I think you can join us in the battle for that as ex-UGC and ex-ICSSR. There's also, of course, I think being here in this amazing hall with this huge history to it. So Mr. Kale Vispi Bilimoria, who's been very much part of movements for a very long period of time, and the entire staff of the Asiatic Society for this hall and for all the facilities. Javed Mirza, who has designed gratis in support of the center, and the values of the center, the invitation and the graphic, that's Amir Rizvi who has done. Javed Mirza, I think, needs a very special kind of introduction. He has come all the way, and he has been continuously making his points, and I think had many questions to raise in relation to the talk which was given. So I'm sure over in the evening, we'll be able to have a discussion on that. Amir Rizvi, like I said, is a graphic designer who has been designing all these issues. Videography staff members who are there. We will, of course, edit and put it up on YouTube within a matter of days. The catering staff, a very special thank you for the tomatoes which were used in the sandwich, which were really, I think many of us were tasting these tomatoes after a very long period of time. The entire team of the Askar Ali Memorial Committee, some are here, some could not be here, and have sent their apologies. Farooq Waris, Daryl DeMonte, Saeed Mirza, they were just not able to come. Also the entire team of CSSS. And I think most important is all of you who have come and the audience, because I think without the kind of support which has been shown, particularly today in terms of the numbers of people and particularly the young who have come for this program, we cannot take this entire vision forward. So my request is to not just see, of course, what has been discussed today, but also to question the kind of issues of untouchability which are taking place on a daily basis, whether it's individual, whether it's social, or whether it's at a broader level now. And in this context, I just want to see one or two things which we riff all the time. As an economist, I've been working on informal sector. And the issue, I think, what you raised about economic empowerment and economic structures, economic power structures, is extremely important. Because everywhere you go, if you see the wages which are given, of course, they're low for everybody. So 100 rupees wages, say, take 150 rupees wages. Wo Dalit workers ko aur Muslim workers ko 2 rupees kam denge. And it's not that 2 rupees is a huge amount of profit which is there, but unki aukaat dikhane ke liye, unki jagah dikhane ke liye, to make a point that you are lower than the others. There is also a question which, of course, we keep answering, whether it's a women's movement or in the Dalit movement, is the fact that when Anganwadi worker, agar wo aurat hai, agar wo khana pakati hai, to bacche nahi bheje jayenge kyunki wo Dalit ke haath ka khana nahi khayenge. But there's no question of untouchability when you rape these women. That is one issue. The second, I think, which is becoming a very, very major one today and which we are all aware of, is that you will not drink water from Dalit's hands. But when you are bathed in the blood of a Dalit who you hack, where does your issue of untouchability go in that? So my appeal to you all, particularly the younger lot, is to please take this vision forward and to question these kinds of inequalities which permeate at every single level, not only individual, not only public, but now I think what is very, very important, going beyond that into the broader public, what we call vigilante groups, or with a total silence which takes place and the kinds of sanction which it brings. And please remember that the greatest friend of anything which is evil is the silence of good people. And I request you, please don't play silent. Thank you very much.